This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Jennifer!
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
I am fabulous. How are you?
I'm so happy to see you in your hat.
I love my hat.
It is gorgeous.
I love them. I love them. We're just one.
Well, what I also love about our podcast is here we are, haven't spoken since last week, and our podcast is outside of time, you know. I mean, we might as well be in, you know, whatever, Rangoon.
Sorry.
And that's quite all right. And I know we don't have a lot of time today, but I just wanted to reflect on the fact that we've had some very interesting conversations in the past few weeks of people just knocking on our door, showing up and wanting to elbow their way into our classroom.
Always, it seems like, always.
And, but first things first, just to mention our friend Luana Anders, who's on the flip side, who helps assist us with our guest list, whoever wants to talk to us. Go ahead. Just wanted to see if Lou was around, if she wants to bring out the list.
Okay, this is much better, isn't it?
Oh yeah, your voice has changed. Yes, much deeper now. All right, so Lou.
It's much deeper now.
Lou, what have you got for us?
Why are you saying that? Okay, were you, hold on a second. Is there, why is she, are you editing? Okay, you already told me this. But she's mentioning editing. She first made me feel blue suede shoes, which can go into a ton of different directions. And then I feel like she's mentioning, hold on. She's mentioning the fact that you're editing. Hold on.
That's correct. And if we want to break it down.
She's, okay. She said they'll do the editing. You just have to keep asking questions about it.
Okay, very good.
Door.
Okay, very good.
Yes.
And I, as Jennifer has disappeared from view, I will tell the audience listening in that what Luana is referring to, those two things, blue suede shoes, that is a chapter in the book I'm editing right now. Literally, the chapter.
I did not know.
Yeah, I know. What the chapter opens up with a photograph of blue suede shoes. And so she's pointing out that what I'm editing, which is not like film editing, it's literary editing.
Okay, and just for the audience, now I'm talking over him again, just for the audience to know, when we got it, we never plan anything, as you guys know. I'm looking at my little book, my little
notebook,
clipboard, that I, my version of a clipboard. And he said he was editing a book, but I had no idea about blue suede shoes. I'm just thinking it was blue suede shoes because I went to, is it Elvis? What are, you know, then there was so many other things, you know, anyways.
Well, so, and we've talked cool about this process quite a bit, which is Jennifer's getting a visual or an image. And I've talked to many people who are confused about images they get and they want to know about them or, you know, and the idea is you're trying to translate the image. So somebody else might have said, oh, blue suede shoes, she needs to go shopping. She needs to buy some clothes. Somebody else might have said something else. But in this case, it's a reference to something I've put together. The chapter, one of the chapters of this book is called Blue Suede Shoes. And what she's saying is, and now the next thing that she's saying is, when you're editing, when you're talking to people on the other side, they're helping you converse. So you think to yourself, well, I got a question for you. And they'll say, well, I gave you the question to ask me. So go ahead, Lou. What else?
That is so interesting. That's fascinating. I'm always fascinated by this work, by the way. Oh,
me too.
Can I tell you a little something I have? So I did something yesterday. I read a family last night. And I'm sure they're not going to mind me saying what this particular part of it. This guy came in and it was this person's husband who passed away suddenly. And his name's Alan, actually. His name's Alan. He came in. He's actually famous in Hollywood, believe it or not, for sound. He's one of the top four sound people in Hollywood that passed away recently. Anyway, that means nothing. But he came through and she's just like, he's saying that there's something about a ring. And she goes, yes, I don't know where. She goes, yes, the ring is. I'm like, it's his ring. She goes, yeah, it's lost. She goes, I don't know where it is. And I'm like, okay. And I tried not to make it morbid where there's a clean, there was, a, I saw a clear plastic bag with some items in it. And I said, and then I'm being shown it's not in that bag. So I, of course, went into my investigative side, because I've never seen it. You know, whenever this happens, I'm like, okay, was it the nurse? Was it the, you know, did he die at home? Or was it with the healthcare practitioner? And blah, 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 whatever it is. And I told her, I said, it wasn't in there. She goes, yeah, it wasn't in there. And then he started showing me other stuff. And I started going into my investigative side. And this is what I want you guys to understand too, audience. When you start thinking too much, you lose it. You lose what they're trying to give you. And so I'm just like, you know what? I'm just gonna have to wait, because he's just kind of being a pain in the ass. And they all started laughing, because that's exactly how he was. Then I went back and he told me, he goes, I lost it before I died. So he already lost his wedding ring, but she didn't know.
I see. Oh, so they weren't even aware.
Nobody took it. She goes, oh, I was asking him for 2 months before. Where is his wedding ring? Didn't think about it. And then he dies. And then we don't have a wedding ring. And I'm like, he says, stop looking for it, because he doesn't know where he lost it. But it was just the funniest story, you know. But again, I'm trying to use this as a teaching moment. And I hope you're not lost. I would be listening to myself, but that's a whole different story. Pay attention to when you get information, and as Rich has taught me throughout the years, do not judge it. Because the second you start thinking about it or putting your own equation to it or putting your own thoughts to it, you're going to lose the message. You'll right. get bits and pieces. I've done it enough to know, okay, you know, when I'm working on a crime scene with someone, if it starts getting fuzzy or blurry, or if I'm not, if it takes too long to get the information, I'm like, it's called like an energy blitz. I just cut it off. And I wait until I have fresh eyes the next day, or I wait a few hours that night. Don't get frustrated if you're not getting something the way that you want to get it, the way that you want to receive it. Be patient. Go back to it later. Because if you want something so bad, it's not allowing it to come in. Mm. And I know that people get stuck on that. You probably have heard that as well.
Yeah, I was just on Quora. You know, I answer questions about hacking the afterlife. And that has come up quite often, which is people really want to talk to their loved one, but almost always it's they want the questions answered that are bugging them. And so right. they spend a lot of time like, why did you, or why did this? And what I try to say, and I learned this from you, of course, which is just allow what's happening, be present. So how are you is a much more right. interesting question to ask than why did you screw everything up, or why did you leave me? You know, right. how are you? Who greeted you on the other side? Try to start the conversation, or try to create a conversation so you can actually converse. And this is why, you know, I say to people, don't expect to hear the answer to your question, but you might get a visual. Yeah. So Jennifer just gave a perfect example, which is yeah. where's the wedding ring? And she's seeing a plastic bag that's empty. Anybody could make up anything around that, but eventually she came to the conclusion, oh, he's showing me that it wasn't there because he had lost right. it a long time ago.
Right. Now, and that the plastic bag represented the belongings that you get after someone passes.
Right. They usually put in a plastic bag. And this happened in my own life, where when my parents, when my mom passed away, there were some rings, there were some, you know, valuable rings and stuff like that, family heirlooms that went missing. And I went through the whole trauma of trying to figure out, did I screw up? Did I put it somewhere? And then the people who took care of the house, you know, did they? I went over and over and over. And this is just really, this was 2011. And I put the question to people on the other side. And the answer I got was, before I met Jennifer, was they are where they're supposed to be. And yeah. that was such a profound thing to hear, because they had a great, you know, strong connection to these heirlooms, these things, these items. But I heard clearly they are where they're supposed to be. And then with Jennifer's help, we figured out that the person who had stolen them was somebody who, whatever, there was a whole thing that theft changed that person's life. Whether it's completely accurate or not isn't important, because I got the feeling of, okay, On the other side, they're fine with it. Don't worry about it. Let it go. It's fine. Don't be connected to that. Where is my thing?
That, yeah. And every time, so, and also you guys, anytime you put your parents in a home or you have people come in, replace their belongings with fakes. Do not take the real ones. Take the real ones, lock it up in a safety deposit box or put it with your, you know, wherever you feel it's safe.
Why didn't you tell me that before?
It's a huge, because I didn't know you before.
Previous lifetimes.
Yes, many times over. But it is a huge racket.
You just don't think about it.
It's awful.
Yeah.
But I hear that
over and over. Let's go. That's great advice.
That was just a fun story because I've never had someone admit to, like, no, dude, I lost it.
That's funny. Brilliant. So, Luana, what would you like us to chat about today? Or who? With?
They're saying Scotty. And so I, of course, thought of Scott DeTambel.
Well, let's ask, Lou, which Scott are you referring to? Is it somebody that Jennifer and I know, or is it somebody that you know that you knew
it's somebody that you know.
Somebody that I know.
Yeah.
And is it Scott DeTambel, Lou? Or another Scott?
No, it's Scott DeTambel. I did see a picture of him in my mind, but I know him too. But they're saying, yeah, it has to do with Scott DeTambel.
All right. Interesting. Let's talk about that for a moment, Scott, for those tuning in.
Okay.
But
okay. Before it goes away, they're saying that you've talked to him about his process.
Yeah.
Okay. And this was, I don't know if it was a few months ago that you did.
Well, it's in the film Hacking the Afterlife.
Okay. Hold on. He's saying that Scott's doing really well because of that movie, but also because of what you guys did or because of the content. Does that make
sense? Let's talk about that a little bit, because sometimes we talk about process here. And Lou, right, if that's what you want to chat about. And the process meaning accessing the flip side. And as people know, Jennifer and I have worked in this unusual way, her being a medium. And as I like to point out, mediums' filters are a little different. They can bypass the blinders that we wear, they don't. So they get to see more of their vista than we do. That's just a simplistic way of putting it. Scott's a hypnotherapist. He was trained by Michael Newton, quite a few other hypnotherapists. And he teaches. He has a teaching method of how to do past life regression. And Scott's a virtuoso, as I call him. He's at lightbetweenlives.com. And I've worked with him quite a bit, and he appears in the books because, of course, you know, he's sometimes the person doing the hypnotherapy, and he's in the film demonstrating because it was filmed during one of his teaching workshops where he's demonstrating the methodology of talking to someone and repeating what you're saying to help them to access what they're trying to speak about. And in the film, there's a fella from Ventura. I can't think of his name right this second, but he recalls his life planning session, which is very precise and very detailed.
Wow.
So it's an, you know, it's him, Pat Pothier. It's him seeing the process of how he chose his lifetime, of the things that he wanted to learn, and how he talked about it as if going into a library and going through microfiche files and then looking at all of his previous lifetimes and go, well, I need to work on this. I need to work on that. Okay, in this life, I think if I do this and this and this, this will help me to. And then when he presented that to his counsel, he describes this moment where he's like at the Hollywood Bowl, where in the front row are all of his counselors. And then behind him are all these thousands of people who are going to participate in his lifetime. Wow. Meaning.
Wow. Yeah, the visual is amazing.
And what I try to reinforce or to mention about that repeatedly is that we all have not only teachers, not only a guide, not only classmates, but all the people that have agreed to participate in our journey, our play. Right. They've all volunteered. I'll play Crazy Uncle Pete. You know, I'll play this person in your life. And we come here and we think, oh, we're by ourselves. We're born alone. We die alone. I mean, that's what people say. We've heard it. And unfortunately, yeah, that's not the case. We're tethered to them at all times. So, Lou, is that what you want to talk about, that process or something else?
No, she wanted to talk about that process, but she also likes, she's talking about the condensed version that you do.
Oh, okay.
That you call your coffee stops, or that you, you know, how you put somebody in, really, like you did with Dr. Drew.
By the way, has he seen the film? I probably has.
He's been really busy. I have no idea. I'm not sure.
I love that. You know, he's such a busy guy. And of course, you know, I excerpted a podcast that we did together where he went to visit his counsel. And the whole time he was saying, what are you talking about? Who's my guide? I don't know who my guide is. And then I said, well, your guide knows who your counsel is. He's like, what's a counsel? I said, it doesn't matter. Ask your guide. Can we visit your counsel? And then suddenly he says, oh, we're in a room with these. Yeah, it's fascinating. I mean, it's an amazing thing, especially because he's a skeptic. He remains a skeptic. Mm-hmm. After the session, he said, or after the podcast, he said, I think you hypnotized me. You know, like, whatever. Anyway, what Luana is saying, correct me if I'm wrong, Lou, is that this idea that we can all access the flip side just by asking simple questions and allowing the answer to come forth and not judging it negatively.
Correct.
So how can people do that, Lou, without me?
She's saying that you, if I'm hearing this correctly, you have to find peace. So whatever that looks like to you, you have to sit there. So thank you. Not having distractions, not having, you know,
set the place, set the stage of peacefulness.
Right. So that's usually, and this is just for starting out. Eventually you can be in a crowded room and do it if you wanted to. I do it all the time everywhere, but that's been because of lots of practice. When I first started this work, I had to have everything quiet, because what happens is your mind takes the longest to quiet down. And once you master that part where you allow versus trying to force it or wanting it or whatever it is that you do, which is, by the way, super, super normal when you start asking questions. Thank you. It's sometimes better. You know how people have seen my little, you know, clipboards or whatever. It's sometimes better to write. So write down the question and then see what comes in, because having that takes away some, that's so smart, the outside noise.
Because you're focused.
Something, yeah. Like I usually, you know, they talk about it, even Tyler Henry talked about it, how it's basically his conscious mind being busy why things come in. So that way you can focus on that.
Right. And so
doodling is very normal for many mediums.
Well, you know, Luana, let's ask Lou this question. So does it work both ways? So in other words, I'm in a room or wherever it is, I've got my list of questions that I want to ask my friend or pal on the flip side. Do they have to focus as well? Do they have to sort of shut down or slow down their frequency to be able to access us?
She said, no, they just need permission. They're us giving them permission to talk to us allows it to happen. Okay.
Let's talk about that for a second.
Okay.
You need to give. Well, I just love the concept. I mean, to me, it's a very unusual concept. You need to give permission. So when you say that, of course, then there's the alternate, which is you say, no, I don't want to give you my permission. And that's, if I may, it's this idea of a religious thing that people have, or vampires. You know the story that a vampire shows up and they're at your door, and the way the vampire lore is, they can't gain access unless they have...
Vampire Diaries.
Well, go back to Dracula, the original.
Team Damon.
Well, I'm just saying, here's the point. You can't get in unless you have permission, you see?
Right. So let me take this a different way, though. So I always tell people that when if you have something, like you said, with religion or something that blocks you, if you don't believe it, the universe lets you think that way. Whatever you think is what goes. So if you ask them not to come in, the universe lets you think that way. It doesn't happen.
Well, it also puts the filters, the blinders on, because you're saying, right. No, I don't want to see that. Yeah.
So you might have to just, thank you. You might, what she's saying is you might have to just practice that. You know, what? Just practice opening up and not being afraid, because no one bad is going to come in and try to give you information that's going to help you.
Well, especially if you're talking to a loved one. And focus on the loved one, and you ask them a question. Now, we've seen this where a loved one says something funny or makes a joke or mocks you because you're so serious about this process. And that's why I often say to people, try to think of it as a game. You're playing a game. And what is a game? A game is that the suspension of disbelief where you are pretending that something could happen, and you play the game. Because the end result is the same. You're playing a game where you're talking to your loved one and they reveal new information. Everything's going to be okay. Everything's fine. The ring is hidden under the and it doesn't matter how you got that. If you subconsciously always knew it, doesn't matter, because you're getting this same information. So the point is, in terms of this process, pretend that it's possible to converse with people no longer on the planet. Focus on the ones you would like to speak to, and that allows you to block off anybody else that might be zipping by.
And like yesterday, last night when I did this group reading, you know, every single loved one showed me that every single person there asked them to be there, gave them permission, asked them to be there.
Oh, that's fascinating.
And they told me, one person got, you know, I'm like, somebody was in the water when they asked permission. And sure enough, she's like, I was swimming. I asked them to be there. Water is a conductor. So a lot of things happen when you're in the shower. You start getting thoughts. Nobody's looking at you naked in the shower, by the way, from here.
We talked about that last week. Anthony Bourdain shower.
But everybody else had a different place. And that's what I was able to validate when they asked, you know, the people to come over. And that's what's so, it's fascinating. They really are there. They're really showing you, you know, it might take some, you know, what I do is I validate what people usually already know.
Yeah. But I just want to be clear, Luana, in this process, what you're saying, number one, give permission. Give permission for them to come forth and talk to you. That's important. And to allow. What are you looking at off camera? Ma'am.
No, I wasn't looking at, I wasn't even looking at anything. I actually was listening in to what she was saying.
What'd she say? That's all right.
what was your question again? Damn it. You just made me.
No, what I was saying was, number one, give permission.
Yes.
People don't think of it that way.
Right.
I'm saying pretend, but she's saying give permission. For them
give
to come
permission
forward.
Because it then takes the filters away, like you said.
Okay. And so then once you give permission, what I try to point, and Lou, correct me if I'm wrong, but the idea of not to ask questions that you've got a burning desire and a vested interest in the outcome, ask questions that are generic and ask simple.
So for instance, I asked a question to my dad. I'm asking my dad, who's no longer on the planet, to be there with my son, who's in Minnesota right now, doing these a few excursions. And he told him, like, how is he doing? And it terrifies me, because I do have a vested interest in how my son's doing. But I can't tell you, my dad showed me a picture of him with just smiles. And then I still didn't believe it. I'm like, so he's doing okay. You know, but I was getting this comfort, and I do feel that my son is doing well.
Well, that's a perfect example, because you're asking somebody on the other side to give you access to new information that they can observe, but you cannot. Right. And doing so allows you at least to allow to write down, I'm seeing you smiling. And then you can ask when they come back. You can say, were you, this happened to me when I was in Tibet. I had learned a little bit about this research, not this, but something, you know, the idea of the consciousness might be able to be accessed from distances. And I used to do an experiment. My daughter was at the time, I think she was 2, 1.5, something like that. And I would, while I was in my tent on Mount Kailash, I would put a mental image in her mind, imagine, pretend, and say, poke mommy in the back and tell her I love her, just to see, is it possible? And I'd focus on it. I'd imagine them, pretend. And then the next day or a couple of days later, I get off of Mount Kailash and I go to an internet cafe and I write to my wife and I said, did anything weird happen? And then I kid you not, you know, she said, our daughter poked me in the back and said, daddy loves you. I mean, literally that phone call that I made with my mind. And I've heard that distance helps the further away.
It does. I make sure, you know, for instance, I have a picture of my son on my phone and I have a picture of my son on my phone. Every time I look at it, I try to see if, you know, I try to check in on him because technically I can see if he's, you know, if he's.
Well, come on, your mom's a medium, please.
I know. But I always like reassurance. So that's why I ask my dad and my dad shows me different pictures that I haven't seen. So that being said, but I, you know, it really is powerful. We've talked about this before. Your thoughts are very, very powerful. Your feelings are very, very powerful. You connect with your heart. Your heart's a cell phone. I tell everybody this because you've told me this, Rich, you know, a while back. When you connect with your heart, after you give them permission to, you know, please be here, they're there. Like before I read a whole audience, I ask for their loved ones to be there. I even ask for their loved ones to be there. And please allow me to be a vessel, or please allow me to interpret the correctly what they want to convey.
You know? Brilliant. And Jennifer, I've been doing this for 6 years. And of course, we've only been doing the podcast for a year. But every time I'd go to her office, on the way there, I would do a mental checklist, which was to say, okay, who do I want to interview today? I'd say their name aloud, not knowing if I could speak to whoever it was, Paul Allen or, you know, whoever it was that I was trying to access. And on the way there, I'd say, and you guys, if you can help with this. And I kid you not, it's, you know, footage, because I'd sit down, turn the camera on and she'd say, you know, Paul Allen's here, or whoever it was that I had, Robert Kennedy Jr. showed up that way. And so did Maverick up that way. And you know, Michael Newton, but you know, how could that be other than what we're talking about, which is we all have the ability to speak to our loved ones on the flip side, all of us without exception. And if you allow that it's possible, you can do so and pull them in. Now, can you ask them for lottery numbers? Yeah, you can ask them, but they usually laugh when you ask.
You did win $1. You, the only time you've asked for lottery numbers, you did win $1. But yeah,
that's true. No, Jennifer,
I've thought about this a lot because, you know, some of the best readings have been the ones that I've gifted people. And you tend to wonder, is it because of the fear when you're getting paid for it? Does that come into play? Or, you know, and it crossed over to the lot, like anybody that thinks they understand how mediumship or being intuitive works, they're like, well, you should be a gazillionaire because you should have won the lottery or you'd be able to. I'm like, it just doesn't work that way. I believe me, it has been documented. There's been mediums that have won and been, you know, or they've sued the person that they gave the numbers to and they won. And, you know, there's been documentation.
Really? That's hilarious.
But I think it comes to the I don't know if it's the pressure. I'm just not sure.
I think it's also an interesting thing, part of process, which is, again, attaching emotion to your question. obfuscates right. the question. It makes it the harder, and the frequency is harder to access. And so it becomes this push-pull. I think you're absolutely right. I found this in a very strange way. My friend Dave Patlick and I used to go to Vegas together, and I discovered while I was playing cards with him or whatever we were gambling, if I counted up the amount of money he won or I had won, we'd lose it. And we just noticed that. And so we did this game of like, if he saw me counting, he would say, game over, let's leave. And I did the same thing with him, you know, and what did we win? $200, something like that, paid for our trip. But it was this idea of giving to somebody else. And this also goes into this meditation of Tonglen. We've talked about it, give and take, where you meditate on healing someone else. It cures you. You're there thinking about healing someone, but, you know, it changes your emotional ability, your amygdala. So I think it's related. The frequency of selflessness, let's call it that, the frequency of helping, of just being pure about whatever it is you're trying to accomplish, a lot of times that's the thing that resonates. Let's ask Lou. Lou, is this accurate?
Well, the other thing that I was just getting with that is you also have it, you know, if that person was supposed to have, the person was supposed to win the lottery. Is that, you know, that's also something that comes down. Is that
right?
You know,
possibility. Is that
the possibility? Like we can gauge, like even with betting, sports betting, I do better if I just pick out the color. Like if I know the team, or if I know, because I love sports so much that if I know the team, it's going to be, again, there's that attachment. Once you have that attachment to an outcome, you kind of lose what's going to happen. It's that threat of energy.
And this is, Lou, I want to ask you about this, because
the best babies, the best mediums in the world would be babies like on an island or something that know nothing, that have no like filtration.
Right, no association. Well, Lou, this is true. This is something that Lou and I used to do, because I just, as an experiment back in the 90s, she had to go to Vegas a couple times for conferences. And I just on a lark said, just go down to the roulette wheel and play the following number or numbers. And every time she'd win. And then we tried it the other way. I was in Vegas and she gave me numbers and I won. But I couldn't, and I was working on the movie Limit Up, there was a soybean trader that came, and we were out standing in the set, and I turned to him and I said, you're going to Vegas tomorrow. Here's the numbers you should play. Play them in order. 1, 2, 3, whatever it was. And he called me up. He said, I won $50,000. So, but I can't go to the roulette table and pick a number. Can't do it. But if I go to somebody who's outside the venue and say, here's the number, go. I've done it with my wife. But Lou, you and I did it. So Lou, how does that work? Let's ask her. She's here. What's the process? What happened? What was going on?
Interesting. Huh. She showed me literally like a string of energy popping over to Vegas. So she's showing me where it's coming from. Like if let's say it's reversed, you're in Vegas and she's over here. And she's showing me, okay, show me again. Oh, the thread of energy, how it's just, it goes over on top and into like, and it, like it comes down and puts energy into that hand. Okay. If I'm reading this right. But then she showed me.
Pick the roulette wheel. Cause those are numbers.
Right. And so then she showed me, if it was just you, she showed me all the crazy, like you picking the numbers. There's too many people there that are doing the same thing, and how massive or constricting it is.
So the idea that she's in the distance and it's almost like a Tesla energy beam bouncing off of, let's say, the stratosphere and down onto me. That's a direct connection, as opposed to the sort of chaos of me trying to pick it myself. Is that it?
Bingo. Okay. But then she showed me the numbers. Were those numbers given to you, or did you see those numbers somehow? Were they given to you? Did you psychically foretell what was going to happen? Do you know what I mean? And when you're away, just like I'm here, you know, for instance, I have my office and this is my home office. I'm very fortunate. I love where I live.
That's a backdrop. Cut it out.
It Kidding. Is not. You can see the trees moving.
It's a good backdrop.
It's not a backdrop. My head's not being weird. I can go like this.
Okay. All right.
Okay. I'm losing it. So it's now I lost it.
Okay. Question to Luana was, what was the mechanism?
Oh, that's it. So there's not that much. Sorry, she brings it right back.
Sorry. Go ahead.
So in my home, nobody's here. I'm able to get information and access information in a great way for people that are not in front of me. So I stayed home today and dealt with my home office again because I have 8 clients, but they're all virtual. And so I'm like, I don't need to pack up and go to my office, even though I love it so much. But it's a quiet space. And then it brings back, thank you. It brings it back to how they said initially, have a quiet space when you're talking to spirit.
Initially, what she said earlier, which is create the quiet space so that you can, and it puts the cacophony of frequency outside of wherever it is, right. What you're trying to do.
Well, I'm like, how do I do that outside? How do I do that with audience readings, you know, with all of that? But they're all there for the same thing. Never mind.
Well, it's also your focus. And right.
And it's years worth of practice, but she's saying that you're there for all the same reason. All the loved ones are there.
Yeah. Everyone's there for the same reason. And it also relates to working with Scott DeTamble, where he puts on this music, you know, he's got these musical things, and it helps set you in that kind of atmosphere of
right.
being able to, you know, access the flip side. Okay, Lou, anybody else? Anything else? Right. I know that's all right. I know we don't have a lot of time today, but anything else you wanted to talk about, Lou, in terms of process or, I don't know, life stuff?
She said, hurry up the book.
Hurry up.
Hurry up.
Hurry up.
And don't forget to ask questions to them.
Right, right.
I'll help you edit. She also said that, for the end of the book, which you can give me at any time, what would the reviews be from them?
Oh, that's funny. We'll do that again.
Like we did. Yeah. She just showed me when I did that before. And she said that both of us, if we wanted to play a game, could both do it, the reviews. Even though you might have an attachment to it, but do the review.
Oh no! Listen, for the audience, it's hilarious. After Jennifer and I met, and I put this book together called Hacking the Afterlife. You know, we did this thing of I said, well, let's ask the people who are in the book if they'll give us a blurb, you know, to put on the cover of the book. Robin Williams gave us love, love. Prince gave us something about jumping off a cliff, you know, that like jumping off a piano, jumping off a cliff, jumping off a page, that the concepts on the page took you into the universe, whatever. Anyway,
yeah.
They were all very unique and very insightful for the person that we asked those questions about.
Yeah.
So,
and the other thing that she's saying is don't get frustrated. Just don't
get frustrated. Yeah.
Because you lose the information and it lessens how you feel later. Over time, you won't get frustrated. It'll become easier and easier for you to accept what's being given. So like for me, I was so afraid of being wrong because I was doing it for other people that it was challenging for me because I was so, it just took a lot longer. Now it's so much easier for me. Now I know that everything they say is correct. It's the way I interpret that could be wrong.
Right.
And so I just have to, you know, fine tune it. But frustration comes with doing anything that's new or anything that's outside your comfort zone. And once you get used to it, you know, even get your friends involved like that. You call your friends for advice. It's very similar to ask for advice from your loved ones above.
So like connecting to them and not only opening yourself up to the possibility they exist, but also asking for help.
Help me in this and show me signs that you are.
Very good. And those, I know you got to go, but But Lou, thank you so much. So this was a more about process today than about anything else. And we love that because it allows us and helps people out there in the world who want to do this on their own, who for whatever reason can't find a medium or a hypnotherapist. Right. But and we're trying to help people show that they can do that. What are you thinking about?
No, I was just, sorry. I was just thinking about all, they were just showing me all of the things that when I give information, how it uplifts to me, even if the information is not for myself. And so when you do it for yourself, even, you know, you're not going to get someone that's going to give you, again, don't ask if you should get a divorce or break up with someone. Maybe you should go see a therapist, but you can also, you can ask them to help you with whatever decision you have made.
Very good.
Does that help? Make sense?
Totally makes sense. Asking for help. It's a prayer. Somebody asked me on the side real quick, asked me the other day about prayer. Prayer is usually a one person thing. This is a conversation. So just allow that you can ask for help and ask them. Thank you, Lou. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you for your talents. We appreciate it. And we will catch you. Catch you on the flip side. Bye. This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on gaia.com via Amazon Prime.